Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the fifth meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking items 3 and 4 in private. Agenda item 3 is consideration of the evidence that we will hear in this session from the Scottish Information Commissioner. And agenda item 4 is considering an approach to delivering the evaluation of the Lobbying Scotland Act 2016. Are members in agreement to take this in private? I'm grateful. And our second agenda item is the evidence, indeed, that we are to hear from the Scottish Information Commissioner. So can I welcome Darren Fitzhenry, the current Scottish Information Commissioner, to this meeting. Darren is joined by Margaret Keyes, who's head of enforcement, and Claire Stephen, who is acting head of policy and information. Can I say good morning to you all? And Darren, could I hand over to you for a short introduction on your report?
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for that introduction. I'm grateful for the committee's continued interest in freedom of information and for the opportunity to assist the committee in its consideration of my annual report and accounts for 21 to 22 and any other matters of interest to the committee. As you'll be aware, my annual report was delayed from its usual September-October laying date due to audit availability. We therefore laid a Section 46 report in the interim to meet our statutory requirements, with the annual report and accounts following in December. It was, as you will have seen from the report, a busy year from a small team marked by extremely high numbers of appeals to the office, with a total of 626 being received across the year, which was the highest number since our initial year of operation back in 2005-06. That 29% increase from the previous year, combined with an existing backlog from the previous pandemic-disrupted year, inevitably created challenges for the team. They have worked incredibly hard in closing 549 cases, the highest number since 13-14. But the sheer number of cases that we received, unfortunately, contributed to some delays being experienced by applicants. We've been working hard to manage these, both in terms of the team's efforts in working on the cases, also keeping applicants informed as to where their cases are, including information on that being put on our website, and also looking at streamlining our internal processes and procedures to try to speed matters up while retaining the quality of the appeals. Moving forward, that will inevitably have an effect on my next annual report, and certainly that the high numbers continued, thankfully reduced some from 21-22, and that coincided with some departures, some changes in the teams and some long-term absences, which has created a challenging environment, which raised case numbers also through quarters 1-2 of the current financial and reporting year. Quarters 3 and 4, we've seen a stabilisation of that, much lower increases. And now that we've got new people in place, we've had a recruitment exercise, we've got three investigating officers coming to enforcement, two are already in place, one due in a couple of weeks, and some support staff, as well as support for a policy and information team. So despite delays in clearances and the like, that's come on, and we're really hoping that that will help us move forward to turn it around and work and build on that stabilisation period. Obviously, appeal work is not the only output of the office. In 21-22 also saw us have 257 proactive interventions, ranging from very straightforward level 1 to much more detailed level 3 and a level 4 intervention. It's an area of work that receives no dedicated resource and is met within our existing capacity. 21-22 also saw us respond to 683 inquiries, helping both members of the public and authorities. And additionally to that, we developed our new improved website, which went online in April 22, creating a much improved, faster, modern and accessible route for people to access our detailed catalogue of guidance and support tools. And we also published our second special report on the impact of the pandemic on FOI in Scotland, research into public awareness, and a survey of FOI practitioners. And so looking forward, if that would be all right, convener, essentially at times of crisis, you know, such as the current cost of living crisis, high inflation, freedom of information and access to information are more important than ever. When decisions taken make a very tangible impact on people's lives over whether they keep their jobs, can afford to heat their homes, can afford to put food on the table, or access vital services, that information is more important than ever. So we've been championing proactive publication, learning from the experiences of the pandemic and that special report, focusing on FOI as a core output of public bodies, and intervening where authority practice falls short. And we're also engaging, as you're aware, with the consultations ongoing at the moment at looking to improve freedom of information law, including dealing with the information deficit caused when public services and public functions are no longer dealt with by public bodies and are contracted out, or new systems are created but not with public bodies carrying out those functions. So this is work that we look forward to contributing and to helping the committee with moving forward.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Darren. And I know we'll address many of those issues in the questions which we will move to. I was just going to open up, really, because obviously today is the three-year anniversary of the lockdown to the day. And I was just really going to, can I thank you in your report for the paragraphs regarding the effect of the COVID-19 pandemic. And I was just going to really pick a little bit at that and ask where you feel you are now in relation to being post that COVID, the lockdown, the working remotely that you did, and whether or not there's any effect on that changing your priorities going forward.
Certainly, there've been a number of lessons learned from the pandemic. We have seen through that a greater emphasis on the importance of proactive publication. So in terms of my prioritisation, looking at ways in which we improve the system of proactive publication and enforce it better are areas that we're going to be looking at. Also, that's tied to changes to the law. In terms of the importance of FOI as a core function, particularly at times during the pandemic when people were moved away in some public bodies from that function to go to other functions. And we saw certainly with the Scottish Government as a prime example of that, we saw the FOI performance badly impacted by those changes, with just that whole infrastructure disrupted. So the importance of FOI being looked at as a core output is something that we're focusing on. And it's my intent to be able to go to chief executives and senior members of authorities, and not just the practitioners, moving forward. In terms of impact on our office, with the high numbers of appeals, we're beginning to see that slowly reduce. We will have maybe 100 less appeals, we think, roughly this year. So there is a difference, but it's still relatively high numbers that we're receiving, and we'll just have to see how that pans out. Looking at some authorities, generally, numbers of requests have reduced over the pandemic overall, and they're not yet up at pre-pandemic levels. One or two notable exceptions in authorities, the Scottish Government, to name them again, being one of the authorities which has seen a different experience with their numbers increasing during that period.
To anticipate that we won't return to the previous freedom of information requests that we had before the pandemic, do you?
I don't see that happening. It's still pushing towards the 80,000. It's not hugely dropped off in terms of numbers, and I think that there might be some reductions, hopefully by increased proactive publication. What we would like to see is more information being pushed out so people don't have to put in requests, but there's always a place for requests because people will have specific information that they're interested in.
That's very helpful. And I suppose the looking forward question, can you see any operational risks coming along that you are concerned about? So that's sort of looking forward. Is there anything on the horizon that's coming towards you that's worrying you?
My departure is probably one of those. Well, one of those things could be done, but yes, you know, there will be a change in commissioners, so that will be a period of change at a time when I know a lot is happening in the freedom of information bubble. So that's something that we have to be aware of. Also, my team as well, there will be some changes in the team inevitably moving forward. In terms of numbers, we really are reactive in terms of appeal numbers.
Yeah.
I am hopeful that we, with us achieving the plateau, we have seen the tide turn and we are going to be making that improvement to drive down the numbers now. If that doesn't happen, if we see another spike in appeals, then really that despite having the new people in, if we're not seeing numbers reduce, then that's when we have to seek additional budgets. I mean, we are seeking changes in our internal procedures to try to have more people at the pinch points to try to reduce numbers there. So we are flexing, making changes all the time to try to manage it within current resource if we can.
That's very helpful. And on the question of resource, Alexander, can I pass over to you?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you. You did indicate in the opening statement about the capacity, and I think we all acknowledge that the capacity issue you've had to endure, but managing that capacity has to deal with the staffing you have and the resourcing you have.
Yes.
And you've already identified that to do the job, you will try to manage it within the resource you have. But is there a case or is there an objective from you to try and see that maybe more is required? Because you are aware of where you've been,
yes,
and you're also aware of where you want to be. But achieving that may not be possible without there being more staff and without there being more resource. Because your casework and the backlog already has been identified and you're managing that. But you're being asked to do probably more with less, and you may need a little bit more to achieve what you want to achieve. And is that where you think you're going to go?
What I'm seeking to do at the moment, now that we've reached the plateau, that's coincided with us getting the new staff on board. Obviously, there's going to be a period of training, which will impact how quickly that has full effect. But if appeal numbers remain roughly where they are now, as opposed to last year,
yeah,
and if and our staff deal with the numbers that we would expect, I would expect to see those numbers coming down within the resource that we have. If we find that's not the case, then that's certainly a point at which I will be going to the SPCB and saying, making a case for additional numbers. The problem in the recruitment is it takes a long time from the recruitment through the clearance process to get it, and it has done. And I want to, particularly at the current times when financial budgets are stretched, I want to make sure that before I ask for the new resource, I really need it. Mm-hmm. There are other things I could always do with more resource. There are many nice to haves. I would love to do more interventions. I would love to do more interventions in relation to proactive publication. But to a degree, I have to cut the cloth.
You've identified there that if you had a wish list, you would do certain things. But at the same time, you don't want to be curtailed into what you're trying to achieve as an organisation. To try and ensure that information is transmitted. So, as I say, I still think that there may well be the requirement for you to seek support to achieve some of the goals that you're setting yourselves, because otherwise you may be setting yourself up to fail. And, you know, I appreciate that you want to progress that, but at the same time, we don't want to be in a situation where you do come back in a year's time and say, well, OK, we tried, but it didn't actually quite work. And we've now found ourselves in a slightly bigger situation. So it would be good to get a flavour of how you want to try and manage that, because I see that as a potential. It's not a necessity, but it's a potential that could happen depending on where you find yourself.
Yeah, Thank you very much for that. As I say, one of the areas that we have been looking at is where pinch points are happening, and we've obtained budgeting approval from the SPCB to take some IO, so investigating officer slots, and create them into deputy head slots, so that we've got increased resilience, and we're also having resource put at where the pinch points are in the process. Yeah. But I appreciate that if we consider that more is required, if things early on don't change, then we'll certainly
You've identified these pinch points, and that's quite good, because it will then give you a flavour as to where you might be.
Exactly.
The other area I want to maybe touch on is the awareness, ability to make sure that people are aware of A, what you can offer, B, what you provide, and C, if you're going to create the situation. Because information is more acute than we've ever had because of that situation. So it would be interesting to get a flavour of what your awareness is, and if you have any plans when it comes to communication. You touched on your website, you touched on some of these, but is there other areas that you can encapsulate to try and support you to make that awareness much easier for the public to understand, and also for you as a management organisation to cope with?
Yeah, no, thank you very much for that. The awareness polling data that we had certainly showed that general awareness of freedom of information remains high. It was within a couple of percentage points from previous data. Where we saw a change was in the middle ground between people who were fairly aware or not very aware. And we saw a movement of, I think, 10-15% between those two grounds. Now, interestingly, there were similar impacts in other jurisdictions. So I think Australia, New Zealand and the UK. UK less of a change generally than us, but there was that bit of a change. And what we've done is, obviously, we've got the website to have more accessible information available for people coming to it. We've pushed out an open update newsletter, which has been very successful and received well. We've got social media, so we're being involved in social media. We've been working with young people to try to get the message out to them, because if we look at if we break down the information into more granularity, we see that young people tend to have less awareness than some older demographics. So we've been working with them in relation to that, which is mentioned in the report. And we're looking to continue that work in that specific area moving forward with the policy and information team. We've also got outreach with the Scottish Public Information Forum, where we're in touch with campaigners, NGOs, as well as public authorities, and occasionally just interested people who join the meetings. So we've got outreach in that regard. We've also got increased liaison now with the ICO, and we've outreach how we improve awareness is certainly something that we want to look at and. Also, not only just generally, but also for disadvantaged, historically disadvantaged groups. And there was a charter a commitment in relation to that made at the last ICIC last year about the importance of that. And interestingly, statistics seem to be telling us that this year, actually, that the number of women who have appealed is actually higher than ever. So actually we're sort of trying to not just increase overall awareness and participation, but also in groups that historically haven't used FOI as much.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Very grateful. Edward, can I pass over to you?
Thank you, convener. Good morning. My question is based around the fact that I seem to hear of more and more people who write letters asking for answers and don't get a timely or a full response. And so resort to FOIs because it seems to be the only one that you will get back on time. I will admit, frankly, there are two organisations in the region I represent that I have given up writing questions to. I just FOI as a matter of course, which costs money to them. But my question is, of the FOIs that you look at, Are you happy that the responses that you've seen are fulsome and open rather than closed and focused on an issue that hasn't been asked?
As you'd imagine, it's variable. we deal, to put it into context, we deal with about 0.8% of all the Freedom of Information requests made in Scotland. So certainly last year, and that's quite a high year, it's that 0.8%. We also deal with the cases where people tend to be less happy with the outcome of the cases and have taken it to review and then to appeal to us. And I don't want us to, by focusing in on that, to miss the fact that out of the applications made, I think about 75% or thereabouts result in some or all of the information sought being provided, and over 50% result in all the information being provided. So I just want to put that into the context. But in relation to the specific question about the cases that we see, which we come in, historically, it tends to be into thirds. So of the cases we get, we generally find in favour of the applicant a third of the time, in favour of the public authority a third of the time, and providing some additional information for the third. That tends to be how it works. In the past year, in the reporting year 21-22, it was closer, I think, to about 50%.
55%. Partly or wholly in favour of the applicant.
So it was a slightly lower figure in favour of the applicants and more cases in favour of the authorities. There are cases that we see where we think that authorities have applied unduly narrow interpretations of requests, and if so, we comment on that in the decisions. Or if it doesn't go to decision, we will let the authority know that and see whether they will provide the additional information. That does happen. Of course, if anything was to go as high as a Section 65 offence of deliberate concealment, that's another matter altogether. But we are seeing more allegations of those, but we still have not seen a case on Section 65 go to court. So, yeah, variable picture. We do see some authorities not provide the quality of responses that we would want. If we see bad responses, we note those in a register, and then that feeds into our intervention procedure. So I don't know whether Margaret can elaborate on how that works in practice.
Well, probably clear between both of us, yeah. So basically, for example, in my team, if I sort of manage the investigation, so any point that an authority would think, you know, for example, the simple things, if they're late, for example, or there hasn't been a sufficient advice and assistance given, or we think that they've been overly restrictive, narrow interpretation requests, things that are simply haven't played the ball with us, for example, these things are recorded. And then it passes over, and Claire's team does wonderful things with this report.
Yeah, so we combine the intelligence we gather from our case handling system and the stats that we receive, and we look at that, analyse that on a quarterly basis, and determine where we need to take action in terms of good practice to improve practice. So it's a two-pronged approach. We'll have a decision that must go out, but then we may pick up an intervention at a later date to improve practice more generally.
Okay, so the final part of that question, if I may, is that I think I've got some FOIs that are 4.5 months outstanding from one organisation. Doesn't surprise me that sort of 3 months is standard. Do you know who the badly performing? Is there a view of who is badly performing across Scotland? I'm not asking you to name and shame them, but I'm asking you, is there a view of who's not performing as well as they should? And do you think there would be some merit in publishing a league table of the worst offenders to try and get them to lift their standards? Because I think there may be some merit.
There is certainly, in terms of the process that we've just mentioned there, that's the way in which we ascertain which authorities we are concerned about and have problems and need to improve their performance and we will then proceed with an intervention to help them improve that performance. Now, I do see interventions as a way of us helping the authorities, because sometimes it's because staff have left, sometimes it's a lack of training, lack of awareness, but we want to target those things so that we can fix the problem and help the requesters. So in terms of the authorities which we think have got the greatest problems and have got the latest practice, the greatest practice difficulties, those tend to be the ones where you will see the higher grade of intervention. So the more serious the problem, the higher the intervention. So
publish.
Level two interventions. And we do publish that information. We have it on the website, actually, now,
yes,
don't we?
Not only do we publish our intervention activity reports, we also publish quarterly statistics. So all 510 Scottish Public Authorities report to our office on a quarterly basis on their performance, and that is published on our website.
That will save me an FOI, and I better just check to see if my local authority is up there. Sorry, convener, thank you.
No problem. Thank you, Edward. Colette, can I come to you?
Yeah, thanks very much, convener, and good morning to each of you. I just wanted to look at the interventions element of it that you've touched upon, and just from the commissioner's point of view, just to seek your views on why there's been a 48% increase in interventions to the Information Commissioner.
Yes, perhaps.
Yeah, I think last year we did a bit of work by looking primarily at publication schemes. So we did a lot of work in that area, we noted a few public authorities that we had to open interventions for to primarily look at their publication scheme, make sure that was all up to date. So that was why there's a jump last year in the number of interventions at level one.
Okay, thank you. And to what extent are the issues with the Scottish Government's FOI practice, how have they been resolved?
Yes, so we obviously we've got the level three intervention ongoing with regard to the Scottish Government. That was one where we started off back in 2018 with the early work on that, getting the report, putting in place a work plan to make the improvements. And we saw substantial improvements in terms of timelines, timeliness. It was up sort of in the 90%. We saw training taking place. We saw substantial reductions in numbers of more trained individuals carrying out the casework of the thing. And everything was going brilliantly well until we got to early 2020 with the pandemic. And as I alluded to earlier on, the infrastructure in relation to that disappeared. It was completely fragmented, and a lot of the work which had been done to put the systems in place to make everything work disappeared, and that caused, obviously, major issues in terms of timelines, performance, and inevitably quality as well. That will be an impact. So also with the pandemic, my planned assessment didn't take place in 2020, it would have been, or 2021. So last year we had our first detailed assessment for some time. When we drilled deep again, it was a mini deep dive into the performance. And we discovered for a 2-year period, just before the pandemic and going to the year after the pandemic. And we noticed a number of areas that had improved. So we saw improvements in terms of, one, the most obvious one was journalists and researchers not being dealt with immediately by SPADs and ministers. The position was no longer a default. It depended on the seriousness of the case or the complexity of the case. So there was a triage system to put it out to the appropriate bodies. We also saw that the FOI unit was being has a sort of greater visibility within the government and was being listened to more and was providing the expert advice in relation to this. So we saw a shift away from what we'd seen in the first deep dive when there was more dispute. We saw the visibility and the value of the FOI unit increasing. So that was another very good point. Areas where we saw matters And obviously performance is now back up at the mid-80s or mid to high-80s. We want to see that increase a bit more. In terms of where that goes from there, some of the downsides was really non-compliance with procedures. So the procedures were now there. And the first time when we looked, the procedures weren't very good. They were confusing. They didn't work. Second time, the procedures were there, but there was a lack of following them in some cases. There was a lack of recording information within the where it should be, and in particular in relation to cases where it had changed from being a case to be decided by officials into a case to be decided by ministers. Those were cases where we didn't always have the audit trail, and in many cases we didn't have the audit trail, as to why things were not working. So that's a problem, and generally there was a problem in terms of providing us with reliable statistical data. The system being used wasn't fit for purpose, it wasn't working as it was meant to, and that also meant that the government wasn't getting the information that it really should have to enable it to monitor how its performance is working moving forward. So there are two sort of big issues. And I'm talking broad brush here. Obviously, I can provide any more detail to the committee that it wishes. But two big issues, broad brush. One is that increased training to comply with the procedures in greater detail and have more better trained people dealing with the FOI requests. And that is now happening. I'm seeing positive signs coming in the monthly reporting from the government on that front. The other one is having the IT infrastructure that is fit for purpose for monitoring freedom of information requests in a way that will stop having, hopefully, it will give them visibility of cases that are really late, and it will allow them to track cases which, you know, how long they're on the books, whether they've been dealt with in time, whether they've been dealt with by a minister or not, if it's changed, have a record as to why it's changed. And it's that increased transparency that we're now looking for. So that's what we're looking to test this summer. Before I leave, I want this tested to see where we are so that we can come to a view as to whether we have hit some of those final remaining points.
So it'll be the summer then that we will receive this interim performance report.
That's when we'll certainly be doing the work on it. The report itself might go into early autumn, our report on it.
Okay. Convener, can I just quickly come in on one and kind of moving away from the actual interventions aspect of it? But I just wanted to clarify in terms of, so the likes of Police Scotland, when you're putting an FOI into Police Scotland, for instance, there's obviously an element of sensitivity and security there as well. How do you, you know, clear the lines, if you like, in terms of, you know, what they can provide and what they can't?
Yes, essentially, over the years, we've built up quite a detailed number of cases. We've built up experience of the various exemptions and the application of those exemptions. Out of those, we've put together detailed guidance notes for the authorities to provide a degree of standardisation of approach, relying on the previous decisions that have been made. And when it comes to any appeal, we get detailed submissions, both from the applicant and from the authorities themselves, which then allows us to apply the specific exemptions. And in relation to some authorities, there are more specific exemptions almost tailored for them. Margaret, I don't know if you want to sort of mention in relation to the police some of the common ones in relation to law enforcement.
I also have quarterly meetings with the person who heads up FOI in Police Scotland, just so we can deal with any particular issues which are coming up. Yes, for Police Scotland, there are obviously particular exemptions to do with prevention and detection of crime, particular law enforcement ones, which they'll rely on. But these are subject to a public interest test, so there'll still be the consideration about whether the information should still be disclosed. Obviously, we're all covered by data protection. So the Police Scotland will also, if it's related to a specific individual, particularly if it's in relation to a crime or an alleged crime, then there's certain information that they can't disclose. But they have, Police Scotland perhaps have their own issues in terms of records management, for example, because of the actual costs of Scotland-wide requests. And so it can sometimes take them over the limit of which they don't have to reply. But I know they are working hard on their records management. Final thing, I think, for Police Scotland's probably of all the public authorities in Scotland, they will use the what we call the neither confirm nor deny provisions, where confirming whether information exists, you know, basically gives away. would let you know whether your next door neighbour has been investigated for a crime, you know, something like that. So they use that. So there's a lot of stuff there to prevent the information that shouldn't be disclosed getting into the public domain. But we do give a lot of advice, obviously, throughout. Not just the briefings, but also on a personal basis as well, to authorities as well as inquirers or applicants.
Well, that's interesting. Thank you very much. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Colette. If we just move slightly back to the interventions, the Scottish Government is currently at level three, which means they produce their plan, which you oversee for it. And I know that you produced a report in, I'm going to say, May last year, or was it March last year, for the Scottish Government, and you're looking at doing another deep dive in respect of the plan that they've proposed, and then there will be a subsequent report on that.
Yes.
Is your hope at that stage that they can move from a level three intervention, or do you think the concerns that you have seen, and actually, to be fair, the size of the organisation, the complexity of data, particularly the statistical data that you talk about, is such that this may be an ongoing best friend exercise where you're there to help and assist?
I obviously can't prejudge what I'm going to find, convener, but all authorities are being monitored, if I put it that way, that even at the end of an intervention, once an authority's intervention has completed, we still, as we've discussed earlier on, monitor the performance through the month, through the quarterly inputs from the authorities. Any additional information we receive from other sources, any other intelligence, all feeds into that. And then we look at those authorities. Mm-hmm. And we have had cases where we've had authorities in interventions. They've improved. We've managed to end the intervention, and then we see the performance slip again, and we get them back in again, so that they know that they are monitored, and the improvement we're looking for is sustainable improvement. We're not looking for quick fixes, and then they think they can get away with it. The monitoring continues regardless.
So you remain a critical friend for all organisations.
You do our best.
And I think it's also right and proper to point out that there is one organisation that is currently at a level four intervention. Is there anything that you can say about how long you anticipate it remaining? Because that's the highest level of intervention that you
yes.
undertake.
In essence, a level four intervention means that we've used our formal powers in relation to that. So in this one, it was a practice recommendation for Aberdeenshire Council. That's something which we would expect to see that intervention end imminently.
That's very helpful. Bob, could I come to you?
Thanks, convener, and thank you for your evidence so far. It's been really helpful. You mentioned at the start of your contribution we're going through a period of change. At some point you'll be demitting office as well, and should we wish you well for the future when you're no longer in office. It's a day for changes, really. It's a time for changes. But one thing's we're not trying to get rid of you early, Commissioner. Mr. Mountain was suggesting that this was your last day. I wasn't doing that. But there's other transitions, because the Scottish Government's consulting and changes to, I think consultation may be closed now, but it has
yes.
been consulting on freedom of information. A number of changes suggested in relation to extending the organisation subject to FOI, the use of Section 5 to add bodies to that list, a gateway clause by which third-party organisations fulfilling public functions that maybe avoid FOI currently could be brought into the gambit of it. So quite a lot of potential changes there. Also potentially within the scope, understand what I might refer to as the the Hancock Clause, and that would be the Section 60 Code of Practice for informal communications such as WhatsApp, and whether that guidance around that, and whether that should be subject to FOI or otherwise. So quite a lot within the scope of that consultation. I'm not necessarily trying to draw you, Commissioner, on your views on these, but in the first instance anyway, whether the government's got the scope of that consultation just about right, and any reflections that you'd wish to make. Not particularly in the Hancock Clause, but more generally.
Thank you very much for that. And actually, yes, we've been spoiled for choice, like buses coming along at once. We had the two consultations, so we had the Scottish Government one, and we also had the Private Members Bill consultation. And we've, as you'll not be surprised, we've tried to ensure consistency of approach across both consultations. I'll deal first of all with WhatsApp, because it's I know it's a topical issue, but it's also an issue that's been around for a while, and it's an issue that we have addressed throughout the years, and maybe most recently it was one of the issues that I raised in my second special report on the impact of FOI of the pandemic on FOI in Scotland, which was that increased use of social media by authorities, and the importance of making sure that information was captured and searchable and disclosable. So that's one of the areas, and our guidance on this has actually been consistent for some considerable time. Looking at our guidance for public authorities includes the following. It suggests that they read our briefings and guidance. And looking at searches, we ask that they search which sets of records or data were recorded, which may be held, including information which may be held on WhatsApp or mobile phones, etc. In our Section 17 briefing, we also refer to information held in other formats, such as WhatsApp exchanges or recordings of Zoom meetings as well. So this is a point that's not new. It's a point that is recovered. We do have case law in terms of our decision notices, in which we've specifically referred to this in the past and looked at such documents in the past. But yeah, it's a concern that the authorities be aware of it and know what platforms people within those authorities are having conversations on relating to their functions, and making sure that those are recorded and searchable.
Commissioner, just before you move on to, yes, the rest of the potential scope of consultation or indeed legislation, I'd particularly ask whether that, and I have to admit I am no expert on the Section 60 Code of Practice, I'm able to read it out because it's in front of me, Commissioner, but I now know it exists. So I'm just asking whether or not there's the need for greater clarity, and I should point out, it was a glib comment calling it the Hancock Clause. I've no particular desire to defend Matt Hancock in the slightest, but I'll make a serious point now, which is I can imagine those in positions of office and power wanting to communicate quickly and freely with a whole range of officials and stakeholders in very short, condensed formats just for speed. They need to be really careful what they put in on those platforms, because not everything's captured in a text or an abridged WhatsApp. So yeah, it's not just about shining absolute transparency and what those in power are really thinking. It's also making sure those in power are very clear about what the expectations are. So with that caveat, do we need to get clarity, and does that clause need, that I don't know exists, Commissioner, does it need to be clarified or updated?
Yeah, I mean, the current Section 60 code does refer to checking of systems, and that doesn't only relate to IT systems, but can include any other systems. So there is reference there to something that could cover it. Okay. The code is probably due for a refresh. Obviously, it's not controlled by myself. It's issued by the ministers, although the ministers do need to consult with me. I'm sure they do need to, the statute requires that. Sorry, before I... They do need to consult with me before it's changed. But yeah, I think the code is something that should be refreshed to keep it relevant to the particular issues of moment. In the meantime, our guidance fills that hole and expands upon the statement in the code.
That's helpful, and my apologies, I had cut you off in full flow there. You're going to mention other scopes of the rest of the scope of the consultation. Yeah. Any reflections on that?
Yes, I mean, I think it's crucially important that the consultation properly looked at the loss of information rights, the way the public services have been outsourced over the past 20 years since the Freedom of Information Scotland Act came into was enacted. The changes during that time have resulted in loss of rights as more and more services are contracted out or delivered in other ways other than by purely public services. Now, the Section 5 order was a way in which that was meant to be fixed, in which it could be kept up to date. But there have only been three orders since the inception, the last one being the big one for registered social landlords, which was a very positive move. But the reality is it's not keeping pace, and there's therefore a drive for another solution to the problem as to how does the legislation keep pace with the changes. I have, in my consultation responses, acknowledged that the current system is not working as quickly as we would like. However, the concern of a gateway clause, which would just have one clause which would attract, you know, depending on how it's worded, could increase the number of bodies subject to FOI hugely without necessarily giving clarity as to exactly whether body A or body B is subject to it. Lack of clarity for the bodies themselves, for requesters and for the regulator. I have suggested a potential way forward whereby Schedule 1 is examined in more detail, so that the actual list in Schedule 1 is looked at by Parliament, and Parliament can look at specific sectors that it wants to be subject to freedom of information, potentially with a timeline attached, on a coming into force timeline date, so that we can train up each sector, get them ready for freedom of information, ensure that the publication schemes are ready, and have them best set to meet the requirements, increase the visibility of exactly which sectors are subject to it for the requesters, so that they know who to go to and that they've got these rights, and also certainty for us as the regulators. So I think this is a huge discussion. I think it's a really interesting one, and it's one where I'm concerned if it goes the wrong way, we could have a lot of uncertainty, and the system's workability, that sort of 75% of information being provided, I think that could be really put at risk if it's not dealt with properly.
Can I just check, Commissioner, and I do have one final question that I specifically want to ask, but before I get to that convener, I don't want to misinterpret what you might be saying, Commissioner, but it's almost as if you're saying the government and Parliament should take a considered, almost incremental view on how we extend FOI on a sector by sector basis to consider the implications, get the balance right in each sector, and implement changes accordingly, rather than looking at everything all at once and trying to legislate at haste. We have to consider the evidence we've heard this morning, and that might be something I might have said in a private session where we were considering that evidence, but I don't want to misinterpret or analyse incorrectly, I think, the point you're making there, Commissioner.
Yeah, I mean, my concern is it's possible to have a gateway clause which would be drafted so as to include anybody which receives public funds or anybody which carries out public functions. The problem with a clause like that is, what's the definition of public functions in that? How many public funds? How do we evidence who's subject to it? How do we keep track of who's subject to it? And my consultation responses, I go into a lot of detail on that specific point as to the benefits of the current system, the benefits of the gateway clause, the risks of both of those systems, and what we have suggested as being a potential route that Parliament may wish to consider if it is seized of the issue in legislation. It's simply a regulator's view of the documents which were put forward for consultation. We do go into a lot of detail on those specific points.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Final question is, I understand that there was a very specific recommendation you made. I think it was in relation to, was it Session 5's Public Audit Committee report, in relation to you'd like to replace the current requirement for a public authority to maintain a publication scheme,
so yes.
That's a requirement that currently exists, with a duty to publish information. So I'd be quite keen to know the difference in relation to that, but I know that duty be supported by a legally enforceable code of practice, so it'd be quite helpful for the committee to know the distinction between both those things and the difference it would make.
Yes. So publication scheme is essentially a scheme stating that you're going to publish information about specific pieces of information. That's then contained in a separate document, which is the authority's guide to information. It also sets out, you know, any charges and so on and so forth. So there are a number of provisions, but then it sets out the guide to information, setting out the categories of information which are provided and the actual documents provided underneath that. It's quite a paper-based system. It's based on sort of pre-IT concepts of access to the internet, and it doesn't very well reflect how information is actually published by authorities nowadays. Also, what it does is it allows authorities to say, oh, well, yeah, we've got the publication scheme. Yeah, we've got a guide to information. And it doesn't necessarily have that focus on the publishing of information, the pushing out of information that is in the public interest. And what I would really love to see is that move, that sort of openness or transparency by design move towards authorities wanting to push out information and the code of practice enabling and helping them push out information in a structured way, in a way that makes sure that information that's in the public interest is there, and including requirements to carry out annual reviews to make sure that they're pushing out the information, that they've considered the freedom of information requests that they've received over the course of the year to see what the public's interested in and think about proactively publishing that information, which will help. Mm-hmm. So it's a shift in attitude almost more than anything else, away from I've got a document and therefore I'm complying with the law, to thinking positively and proactively about pushing out as much information in an appropriate and accessible way for the public.
Again, just so I don't misinterpret that, which I think is incredibly helpful, under the current situation, it feels very process-driven. I've got a policy, I've got a document, I've got a process, it's published, it sits there, I'm compliant, tick, let's move on and let's brace ourselves for what requests come in now. And we've got a policy on how we process those requests, rather than turning the whole thing on its head and saying, we're an open public body, how are we going to actively publish the information we think is in the wider public interest for that transparency? I just want to make sure I've captured it correctly, because again, we need to kind of consider the evidence we hear this morning.
I think that's a very nice way of putting it. It is exactly that shift. Away from undue process and towards that, just that desire and implementation of the desire to push out as much information in an accessible way to the public.
Thank you very much. No further questions.
Thank you, Bob. For clarity, that as you said, you wait an eternity and then two buses come along at the same time. There is also the private members bill, which you've also responded to the consultation as one. Is there anything in respect of the private members bill that you were glad to see being proposed, or indeed was in one bill but omitted from the others' proposals?
Certainly proposals on proactive publication, yes. was very much one that I was welcomed seeing being pushed forward in the private members bill, and also mentioned in the Scottish Government bill. If you will excuse me, convener, the two have somewhat merged, yes. in my mind, so I wouldn't be able to give you a blow by blow account of the differences. I'd be worried about making an error.
No.
As to which
and there will be a time for that in due course. The sort of final point that I wanted to make comes from your report, where In your statement, you say that it's clear that a strong and effective FOI, Freedom of Information regime, and the openness and transparency it creates remains key in supporting accountability, strengthening participation, and building trust in our public services. And I was just going to echo that because of all that's needed. And I think we've heard a lot of evidence today about the importance of FOI. We've had a hint at the challenges that COVID created when, for very obvious and understandable reasons, resources had to be moved in organisations to service other immediate needs. But it is good to see that it's coming back, probably sad to see it's coming back quite as slowly as it does. And I know that you are in the final period as our commissioner, and I know that the committee will have an opportunity before you depart to talk again. But can I wish you all well between now and that point, and thank you for attending today.
Thank you very much.
I'll now move this committee into private.